We talked briefly about gravity in a previous video. In that video, we said that all objects are drawn together by the force of gravity, but the force is often so small that we don't notice it unless one of the objects is really massive, like the Earth. Then we get a larger gravitational force that we all know as the weight of an object. Isaac Newton developed a general equation that can be used to calculate the gravitational force between any two objects, but we'll wait and discuss that particular equation later in the course. For now, I'll introduce a simpler version of that equation that can be used to calculate an object's weight, and we define weight as the gravitational force between an object and a celestial body like the Earth or the Moon. The equation for the magnitude of this gravitational force, or weight, is this, or it's sometimes represented with a W for weight. In this equation, m is the mass of the object, and g is the gravitational acceleration. The value of g depends on where the object is located. In most of our applications, the object will be near the surface of the Earth, and g will be 9.8 meters per second squared. We'll continue to define near the surface of the Earth as up to about the height of an airplane, which is around 40,000 feet or 12,000 meters. Examples of some other values of g are near the surface of the Moon, g is 1.6 meters per second squared, at the location of the International Space Station, which is in low orbit around the Earth, g is equal to 8.7 meters per second squared, and near the surface of Mars, g is 3.7 meters per second squared. Those are just examples. The only one that students are expected to memorize is that the gravitational acceleration near the surface of the Earth is 9.8 meters per second squared. Why is g called the gravitational acceleration? I'll explain it by working through an example. A 0.5 kilogram ball is held in the air and released. If air resistance is neglected, what is the acceleration of the ball as it falls? We can consider this question with Newton's second law. First, draw a force diagram. Since we've neglected air resistance, the only force acting on the ball is gravity. Now we'll apply Newton's second law in the y direction. So the only force on the left side of the equation is the gravitational force, or weight. And we know that the force of gravity is mg, so the equation becomes this, and we can cancel the masses. So the acceleration comes out to be negative g. Plugging in a value for g near the surface of the Earth, we get that the ball's acceleration is negative 9.8 meters per second squared. So that's the answer to the question in this example, and we can also now answer the previous question, why is g called the gravitational acceleration? From this result that we obtained, we can see that it's because g is the acceleration of an object when it is in free fall, which is to say, when the only force acting on the object is the gravitational force. Note that the object's mass dropped out of the equation, so it doesn't matter what the mass of the object is. And now I'll change the problem to make a point. This time, we'll include air resistance. In this problem, again, a 0.5 kilogram ball is held in the air and released. As it falls, at a particular instant, the air resistance on the ball is 1.5 newtons. What is the acceleration of the ball as it falls? So here's the force diagram this time, where now we have air resistance. Again, we apply Newton's second law in the y direction, and now we have two forces on the left side of the equation, the air resistance force pointing up and the gravitational force pointing down. We can again replace the gravitational force with mg and then solve the equation for acceleration. Finally, plugging in values, we get the answer negative 6 meters per second squared. This time the acceleration of the ball is not g, or 9.8 meters per second squared. The point I want to make then is this. The acceleration of an object is g when the only force acting on the object is gravity, i.e. when it is in free fall or projectile motion. If another force acts on the object, like air resistance in this case, the acceleration of the object is not necessarily g. The next thing I want to discuss is the difference between weight and mass. As we said before, weight is the force of gravity on an object. Because weight is mg, it depends on mass and gravitational acceleration. Mass, on the other hand, is an inherent property of the object, so it doesn't change with location. To make this point, I'll work through another example. a person standing on the surface of the Earth has a weight of 175 pounds. Part A, what is the person's weight and mass on the Earth in SI units? And then Part B, what is the person's weight and mass on Mars, where G is equal to 3.7 meters per second squared, again in SI units. For Part A, we can get the person's mass in newtons just by doing a unit conversion, recognizing that one force pound is equal to 4.45 newtons, we can convert the person's weight to 779 newtons. And then to get the person's mass, we can use the equation for weight and solve it for mass, and then plugging in values, we get that the person's mass is 79 kilograms. Now let's do Part B. The person's mass that was determined in Part A is also the person's mass in Part B, because mass doesn't depend on where the object is located. The person's weight, however, does depend on where the person's located. We can calculate the person's weight within G, and then plugging in values, and being sure to use the gravitational acceleration on Mars this time, we get that the person's weight is 292 newtons. So this is quite a bit less than it was on the Earth. The last thing I'd like to mention is that acceleration is sometimes given in terms of G or multiples of G. You've probably heard a phrase like this before. The race car driver experienced an acceleration of 3 g's in the curve. That simply means that the driver's acceleration is 3 times g. Where g is understood to be 9.8 meters per second squared, so the driver's acceleration is 29.4 meters per second squared. Well, that's it for this video. See you in the next one.